Today we'll begin with a look at hardware description languages, in particular the language called Verilog, and sort of give an introduction to what are the main concepts that are involved over there and how you can use them in order to model hardware design. Okay. Now, a hardware description language, like any other programming language, is not something that can be taught in a class as such. At best, the basic concepts and the theory behind it, what are the main concepts to be understood, can be explained in class. The rest of it can only be understood by actually writing a program or writing a hardware design using the language, right? So there will be one assignment that involves using the hardware description language to model some simple hardware. Verilog is not the only hardware description language that exists. There are more than one. Right? In fact, some of the more popular ones that you might have heard of, there is of course Verilog. Then there is VHDL, which stands for Very High Speed Digital Integrated Circuit Description Language, or something like that. Right? Very strange acronym because it has sort of a nested acronym inside it. But anyway, the point is Verilog and VHDL are the two most popular ones. Apart from that, there are others as well. There is, for example, something called ABEL. Then there are a couple of other things which are proprietary to customers and to specific companies. Okay. What we are going to do is take Verilog as an example, which illustrates most of the basic concepts that are common to almost all hardware description languages. Right? And in particular, we want to understand what makes a hardware description language different from a programming language like C. Okay? So, the first thing that you need to understand is a hardware description language, even though it is a language in which you can write something which looks like program, it is not a programming language. It is not meant to be a programming language. Okay? The purpose of a hardware description language is precisely that, to describe hardware, to describe the behavior of hardware. Okay? Now there are a couple of things that you need to sort of, that I would like to emphasize over here. First is describe, which means I am sort of giving you a code or some written form of what I want the program to do. It's a description. How it gets interpreted, what you do with that description is up to you. Okay? You can either choose to just simulate that description and see whether it matches with, or rather take that as the reference for what the behavior should be like, or you can take that description and try and convert it directly into hardware, into a set of gates. Okay? But by itself, the language does not specify what you should do with it. It is only for, meant for description of the hardware. Right? The second is the word behavior. The idea is that you want to be able to model hardware by describing its behavior rather than its structure. You don't necessarily want to go down to the individual gate and say, okay, you know, this AND gate, that NOR gate, etc. should be connected up in this format in order to achieve this particular piece of logic. That is not the main goal. That can be done using hardware description languages, but the goal is to try and describe the behavior. So, for example, if I had a multiplexer, rather than saying use these two NAND gates, connect them up in this way, then connect the output to some other NOR gate or whatever it is. Instead of that, I would like to say if select is equal to 0, take the input A and pass it to the output, else take the input B and pass it to the output. That is a description of the behavior. Okay? Rather than the structure of what the actual system looks like. right? So that's the goal of hardware description languages, to be able to take the design of, in this case, digital IC, digital system, to a higher level than the individual gate. Okay? You don't want to be stuck at sort of specifying the functionality of each individual gate. You want to be able to specify behavior of large blocks. And using that behavior, essentially construct even larger blocks. Okay? Which brings us to the main core concept or the core unit of a Verilog program. Now onwards, I'm going to use Verilog for all the examples. Right? For those of you who are interested in learning VHDL or who have prior experience with VHDL, there is a pretty much one-to-one mapping between concepts in Verilog and concepts in VHDL. In some cases, there may be something that you can do in Verilog you cannot do in VHDL and vice versa. Right? For the most part, I'm looking at only the common aspects. So the core unit in Verilog is called the module. Right? And in general, your hardware design will consist of a large set of modules, which are all connected together by means of signals. Okay? Now the correspondence with hardware is very straightforward. Each module can be thought of as one hardware block. What do I mean by a block? It means one self-contained piece of logic. It has some inputs, it has some outputs, and it has some behavior associated with it. A hardware block could be as simple as an AND gate, which has two inputs, one output, and basically the functionality is output is equal to AND of the two inputs. Or it could be as complex as a complete ALU or even a CPU. Right? In the case of a CPU, it would have an address bus, data bus, address bus as output of the system because it's trying to read from external memory, data bus for both input and output, many control signals, read, write, bus enable, all of those kind of things. Right? Any other signals that are required for connecting to peripherals, and a clock. All of those would be inputs and outputs of that block. But still, as far as Verilog is concerned, that would be one block. Okay? Now, signals are what are used to connect modules together, and they essentially correspond to wires. Right? Or, alternatively, they can also be called nets. Right? Because a wire sort of indicates a single point-to-point connection between two electrical signals. Whereas a net in general is something which connects one output of some gate to possibly multiple other gates input. Okay? So a net could be something more than a simple point-to-point wire. It could also have points to multiple points. Okay? But in general, that's what a signal is. It just models the concept of a net or a wire. Okay? So now, the best way to sort of understand what Verilog would look like is to take up a very simple example, take up some very simple examples and sort of go through them in order to understand what a Verilog program or a Verilog module would look like. Okay? So let's take a very trivial example to start with, a two input AND gate. The way that it works is, the first thing is I would have a module declaration. I would give the module a name. And I would give it a list of ports. Okay? The first thing I need to do, which makes this different from a typical C program. In a C program, I would not just have declared A, B, C, I would have declared maybe int A, char B, something of that sort. So the type of the variable would be declared over there. Right? The assumption here is that you don't necessarily have a type with any variable. What you do have is whether it's an input or an output. Okay? because this is a module, it corresponds to a block of hardware. So I don't really care about what type of data is feeding in, whether it's a number or something else. As far as I am concerned, it always has to be some kind of digital data, some combination of wires that can be passed in or out. Okay? So in this case, what is more important to me is to know whether it's an input or an output of the system, and that is the first thing that I need to declare. So A and B are declared as input, and Y is declared as an output. By the way, it's entirely possible that in writing all of this, I will make some syntax errors. Okay? I do not know the syntax of Verilog by heart. There are almost certainly going to be some errors in what I write down over here. What you need to keep in mind is, you need to know the general idea of what the syntax is. Beyond that, it is in general the compiler that you use in order to simulate or actually run your program will tell you whether there are any errors and give you pointers of what needs to be corrected. Okay? So that's usually acceptable. Because otherwise learning these things by heart is entirely possible. There are so many different rules that you are likely to make mistakes. What you need to understand is the general concept and how to sort of make use of them in these designs. Okay. Alright. So now comes the interesting part. How do I actually model a two input AND gate? Okay. And one possible way of doing this is by saying AND A comma B comma Y. That itself, right? So AND 2, in other words, internally just has AND of A comma B comma Y. Now this works because AND is a special case. It turns out that two input AND, two input OR, etc. already have some basic functional modules that are defined into the Verilog language itself. Okay? So if you want to implement AND of two inputs, you can directly use the word AND like a function call and give this value over here. Okay? And then I would end the module by names of the word end module. So this is, like I said, a trivial design, right? You are actually implementing something which is already there in the language. The important point is, I could also have chosen to write this in a different way, where instead of this AND A comma B comma Y, I write it as assign Y is equal to A ampersand B. Okay? The important thing to note over here is this is a different style of modeling. What has happened now is, I am saying that the value Y is computed using A and B by using the AND operation, and this is assigned to Y. This is something called a continuous assignment. In other words, at all points in time, at any given time instant, the value of Y should take the value of A and B. A and B. Okay? The AND operation applied to that. Right? Which also brings us to another concept, which is time. Time is again something which is not really present as far as a C program or something like that is concerned. A program might take some time to execute, but that is just the amount of time that it takes to run on a CPU. So if you run it on a faster CPU, it will take less time. Right? Whereas over here, there is a concept of time within the system itself. Of time such that a signal changes, after some time the output of that, the output is reflected as a change. That in turn can cause other things to change and so on. Okay? So the concept of events happening one after the other is one of the core concepts of Verilog. Okay? That there is a possibility of events or something happening at a particular time instant, and that being followed or that being the cause of some other event to happen later. Okay? So, in this sense, the assignment statement, assign y is equal to a ampersand b, is saying at all instants of time, whenever you evaluate this, whenever you look at the system, you are going to find that y takes the value of a ampersand b. In the same way, this is called a structural instantiation. Structural instance. Right? An instance just means a particular occurrence of a piece of hardware. So a structural instance just says that this is one particular occurrence of this AND gate. The meaning is the same. Once again, what it's saying is at any instant of time during the operation of the system, if I was to look at the value y, it would take the value a ampersand b or a AND b. Okay. Now, apart from both of these, there is yet another way of describing the same piece of hardware, which is using something called an always block, which is another core idea as far as Verilog is concerned. VHDL has the equivalent process statement. In Verilog, it is the always block. So what does always block look like? It's more complicated. I mean, it looks like it has a lot more, at least written over there, right? But now take a look at what it's saying. This is what is called the behavioral style of coding. It's making something explicit. It's saying always at A or B. So what does that mean? At any instant of time, supposing either A or B has changed its value. Okay, that's it. It has changed its value. Whether it went from 0 to 1 or 1 to 0 or whatever it is, I don't care. There has been a change in either A or in B. Okay. What should you do? Go inside the always block and perform the functionality given over there. Right? And what is the functionality? In this case, it is just y is equal to a ampersand b. So once again, this also achieves the same purpose as the other two, because it's saying that any time either a or b changes, I will immediately update y. Right? The previous two statements did not really make that explicit. They did not say anything about looking at the values of a and b. It just said something that y should take this value. Whereas this is making it explicit. If A changed or B changed, then immediately go and update Y. Okay? The interesting counter of that is, you don't need to keep on looking at Y. You only need to look at the values of A and B and see when they change. If there is some way of knowing when A or B changes, then you can automatically go and update the value of Y. Okay? So let's extend this to a slightly more complex design. Let's say a AOI and or inverse. Something like this, AB plus CD plus E, the whole bar. Okay. Once again, the module would have A, B, C, D, E and Y as four. Okay. A to E are the input ports and Y is the output port. Okay. Now, how do I write down AB plus CD plus E the whole bar? One possibility is, I take a new variable t1 So what have I done here? I created one AND gate U1, which I am calling U1, with inputs AB and output C1. Okay? Another AND gate U2 with input CD and output C2. Then an OR gate. I can do only two input OR. So I take C1, D2 and compute C3. I take C3 and E and compute C4. And finally I invert C4 to get 1. Okay. So now what has happened is the structural description. Right? It's getting pretty complicated. It has a lot of individual modules that need to get instantiated. Right? By the way, this itself would be module AOI. Okay, I have to give the module a name. Right? So module AOI in turn consists of several different modules that are instantiated inside it. Okay? One of the things that I need to do after that is to say, okay, what about T1, T2, T3, T4, T5? T1 to T4. Right? I use them as intermediate variables. What are they in reality? I can think of them as wires or nets. Right? So T1 is a wire which takes the output of the first AND gate U1 and connects it to the input of the first OR gate U3. T2 is a wire which takes the output of the first second AND gate U2 and connects it to the input of U3. Okay, so T1, T2, T3, T4 are looking like wires, which means I need to declare them as wires. Okay. Now keep in mind there is one small catch over here as far as Verilog is concerned. In my opinion, this is actually a bug. It should never have been allowed into the language, but it has been allowed. What happens is that if you do not declare a wire, if you do not declare a signal, it will automatically assume that that signal is a one-bit wide wire. Okay? Now, why am I saying that this is almost a bug? It should not have been allowed into the language? Because supposing you were actually trying to instantiate something with multiple bits, 4 bits. And you forgot to declare the variable for that, the language will not tell you that there is an error out here. It will assume there is a 1-bit wire, connect only 1 out of the 4 bits, and your simulations will go wrong. This can be very hard to debug sometimes. Okay? So in general, make it a practice that whenever you are writing a program or a hardware description in Verilog, any internal wire or any signal that you use has to be declared. Okay. Now, in all of these cases, as we have seen over here, we are only declaring single bit wires. All of these are single bits that we are dealing with. Okay. Now, here's the interesting thing. What would the behavioral description of this look like? Once again, I could say always at A or B or C or D or E. And the begin end actually is optional over here, right? I can straight away write y is equal to tilde of a and b or c and d or e. Okay? What is this doing? Effectively what it's saying is, I am now describing the behavior. I want this kind of functionality to be implemented. Right? How you implement it, whether you use two input AND gates, two input OR gates, or straight away use an AOI gate, I don't care. The second, the right hand side, what I am giving on the right hand side, is only describing the behavior. It does not tell me whether to use two input AND gates or three input OR gates. It straight away tells me this is the functionality to be done. Do it in whichever way that you know how to. Right? So, for example, in an FPGA, remember what we discussed yesterday about FPGA taking 4 input lookup tables. I would straight away take 4 inputs A, B, C, D and compute part of this functionality. And then the remaining functionality I would compute in the second lookup table. Right? So the behavioral description, in other words, does not pin you down to a particular style of hardware implementation. It just describes the behavior and gives freedom to the implementer to do whatever you actually want with it. Okay? Now, what I could do further with something like this is, I could then have a module, some big module. Inside that module, I actually create an instance of AOI. And I have some T1, T2, T3, T4, T5 as input, and some Y1 as output. So this is an instance of a previously defined module. Right? So what has happened over here is, a module that was previously defined as AOI on the previous page is now being used inside my new module B. Okay? So how does it work? In terms of a programming language, it's sort of like defining a function and then using that function somewhere else. Right? But that's where the similarity ends. I would suggest you don't think too much along the lines of that particular analogy, because a function in general is something like a function call. The moment you call a function, you go into that function, execute something corresponding to that function and then come back. Whereas a module is literally like a piece of hardware. It's as though I have taken a breadboard and connected chips together on the breadboard. Right? Once I connect all the chips, let's say I take a NAND, a four NAND chip, put it over there. Right? Another one which is inverter. Another one which is a D-LAC. Okay? And I wire it up in some way. Now, does it make sense to say that when I switch on the power, first the inverter starts operating, then the NAND gate starts operating, then the D-LAC starts operating, and then once again the inverter operates? No, they are all operating at the same time. Okay? So there is this concept of concurrency. Right? All modules are active at the same time. So in general, when I have a module that is declared and used somewhere, it is not like a function call. It is not as though I am waiting for that module to be called. Once the module has been instantiated, from that point onwards, it is only looking at its input. Okay? If its input changes at any point in time, it will immediately reevaluate and change the output. Okay? If the inputs do not change, that module will sit idle. Okay? So this is actually a big difference between a C-like language and a hardware description language. Right? And it takes some time to get used to. One of the most important factors that you need to keep in mind as far as this is concerned is the order of execution of, the order of, not execution, it's usually called invocation. Right, in the sense that the module is invoked, when something happens to it, it is activated. This is not specified by the program or the language. It's controlled only by event. Okay? So what does that mean? Going back to this example of the AOI, right? Let's look at the left hand side. have declared five separate gates, two AND gates, two OR gates and a NOT gate. Okay. Now, let's say that the input signal, let's say that for some reason all the values A, B, C, D, E were initially zero. Okay. When I look at the system, what I'll do is I'll go through this and evaluate. AND U1 0, 0, output is also 0. Next AND is also 0, etc., etc., all the way up to the output NOR, the NOT gate, sorry, so that Y alone becomes equal to 1. Okay. Now at this point, supposing I change the value of E to 1, leaving all the other things constant. Okay. So what I've done is I've changed the value of E alone to 1, leaving A, B, C, D at 0. What will happen in this situation is, the first 4 gates will not even be activated. Okay. The system is not even going to look at the first 4 gates. It's straight away going to go to the 5th gate, which is the NOT gate. So the first 3 gates will not be activated. It will straight away go to the 4th gate, which is the second OR gate. Compute the value of the output, which is now 1. Put that into the inverter, so the output now becomes 0. So, U4 gets activated, then U5 gets activated. U1, U2, U3 are never even touched. Okay? Now, how did it know that it straight away has to jump to U4 without bothering about U1, U2, U3? Because of the dependency. Right? What changed? Only the signal E. Because E changed, which of these gates was dependent on E? Only U4. Go ahead and evaluate U4. Okay? But now, as a result of that evaluation of U4, T4 has changed. Right? So now what happens? T4 has changed. What are the things which depend on T4? Only U5. So go and evaluate U5. Change its output. Okay? So change E to 1 at time T. I don't care what that time is, but I'm interested in sort of seeing this on a time axis. Okay? So E changes from 0 to 1. Now, the first question that I'm going to ask is, at what time does T4 change? According to this description, E has changed at time T. When does T4 change? In reality, when will it change? In a real system. Propagation delay of the OR gate. Right? So, a real system, a real physical system, the OR gate will have some propagation delay associated with it. So, it will take some time to respond. Okay? But over here, I have not specified what type of OR gate to use. So I don't know how much is the delay of the OR gate. Okay? Because of that, what we do over here is we say that there is actually something called a simulation delta. Right? The simulation delta after this, what happens is Y changes from 1 to 0. This is not before that I should have done something else. I should first have taken T4. T4 changes from 0 to 1. Okay, and then after yet another delta, Y changes from 1 to 0. Okay. Now these deltas are not real units of time. It is in some sense smaller than 1 picosecond, smaller than 1 femtosecond, smaller than any unit of time that you can think of. Right? It is effectively a zero time interval, but it helps us to sort of keep the simulation deltas in mind because it gives us this ability to think of events happening one after the other. Okay? In this case, what is clear is the change in T4 happens after the change in E. There is a cause and effect relationship over there. And similarly, the change in Y happens after the change in T4. Once again, there is a cause and effect relationship over there. Okay? These simulation deltas are just recording that. They are recording what is the sort of chain of events that cause the output to change. Okay? For the most part, you can sort of ignore the concept of simulation delta, except that there are some places with regard to blocking and non-blocking assignments where it actually becomes useful to think about it. Okay? Now, for the time being, the important thing is, how does this entire sort of simulation of the system, why am I calling it a simulation? Because what I am saying is, I have a description of the system, and I have, somebody has told me what changes were made on it. I want to find out what it will affect, how it will affect the system. So I go ahead and look at it and see, okay, as a result of this first change, that in turn caused this change, that in turn triggered some other change in the final output. This process is called a simulation. Right? What we are doing is we are taking the set of inputs that have changed and essentially propagating it through the system in order to find out what effect it has on the output. Okay? Now, simulation is in some sense the primary reason why we write hardware description, why we write programs in hardware description language. We want to be able to simulate a system and see how it will behave. Okay? After you have successfully simulated it, you may or may not choose to directly convert that into a actual piece of hardware by converting each of these functionalities into gates. Okay? The important point is, as far as the initial implementation is concerned, I want to be able to know whether what I have described does the job correctly. Okay? Now, with the behavioral style of modeling, I had always had A or B or C or D or E, Y is equal to something. Right? Once again, E changes at T. In this case, Y changes directly at T plus delta. Why is this? There is no intermediate evaluation of a new variable T4 over here. Okay? So Y directly evaluates to its final value. Okay. So that's another thing you need to keep in mind. Depending on how you write the code, you may or may not have additional deltas, but that may not make any difference to your final design. Both of them will give you the same answer finally. Okay? Now, like I said, the main thing that you do with a hardware description language, once you have described your hardware, is to simulate it. In the case of the AOI, this is an example. What I did is I essentially provided the description of the AOI gate. Then I gave an input, a set of inputs A, B, C, D, E all equal to 0. After some time, I changed E to 1. And I simulated the system and looked at the output and I'm happy that it's working correctly. Okay? In general, that's what you're going to do for any more complex designs as well. Okay? So now, I want to mention a word further about the simulations itself. These simulations use the concept of so-called four-valued logic. So what is four-valued logic and why is it used? What is the logic that we are used to in binary? How many values does it have? Two values, right? 0 and 1. Okay? So what could four-valued logic be? What are the possible things that you could add as a state of the system? Okay. Please understand that when a lot of people are murmuring in the background, I can't get any one word clearly. Try state is one of the possible values, right? So you have 0, you have 1, you have something called a tri-stated value, which is denoted by Z, which essentially is some kind of a high impedance or a floating condition. Right? And the fourth value is X, unknown. Okay? Now this makes the simulation very useful. Effectively what we are saying over here is, you can do things more than just simulating the behavior of gate. You can also simulate whether a system is going to start up correctly and whether how it will behave after you switch it on. Right? The reason why that happens is because simulators are programmed in such a way that they assume that as soon as I first switch on the system, right, all inputs are in the unknown state. So everything is an X. Okay? And if X is operated with anything, so for example, if I have any one input as X and I'm doing an AND operation with 1, right? The output is X. The second one is a bit more tricky. This may not always be the case. Why is that? This depends on the simulator or depends on whether how it is actually getting implemented. Or it may depend on the language itself. The language may specify what you need to do in this case. Why is this a special... X or 0 is... X is fine. Right? But, sorry. This is not a special case. This one. What should be the output here? What happens when you AND something with 0? The output should be 0. Irrespective of what the other input was. Okay, so this one may sometimes be taken to be 0. This is sort of language dependent. It depends on how the interpreter that you are using works. Okay, or in some cases it may be specified in the Verilog language manual itself. Okay, but the important point is the X can now propagate. Let's say one input to a gate is X. It means that the output of that gate is going to be X, right? Something on the input was unknown, the output is also unknown. Therefore, the output of that is unknown and therefore it will propagate through the entire circuit. Everything in the circuit will become unknown eventually, right? Why is that a good thing? Because it can also help you to sort of clarify whether or not after you have started the system, how do I bring everything to a known state? One is if I have any input, those inputs must be set to correct value, so logic value. After I set the inputs to logic values, then those X's will propagate away, they will disappear. Because those correct inputs will then propagate through the entire system with a few deltas and will get correctly evaluated throughout the entire system. If I still have X somewhere after that, it means that something else went wrong. Okay? The most likely cause is that I had some flip-flop somewhere inside the system which did not have an initial value assigned to it. So its output remains at X, even though the inputs have all been given, the other inputs have all been given value. Okay? So this simulating with X's, that is unknowns, and with tri-state can be very useful for catching a lot of special cases or problem cases in your design. It essentially tells you when the system is not initialized correctly or when it's going to behave badly. Right? In between the simulation, supposing some output suddenly becomes X, the only way that can happen is if there's something wrong with your code. You are trying to maybe drive the same signal from two different places to two different values. Okay? Those kind of things can get detected by means of these unknown value operations. Okay? So all of simulation essentially happens using this kind of four-valued logic. Right? Alright. So we have looked at simulation up to the point of what the basic idea of deltas is and four-valued logic. In the next class, we'll look at a little bit further on modeling simple systems using this, and also on how you can model flip-flops and registers, and I'll also describe the problem statement for the assignment, which essentially is to implement a boot encoded multiplier. Okay, so what you'll be doing is, once again, actually speaking, that's a combinational circuit, right? You don't need to worry about flip-flops or anything else for implementing that. You essentially have certain inputs, which are the multiplier and the multiplicand. Depending on how they are done, you cannot just write y is equal to a star b. That won't give you a boot multiplier. That might give you a multiplier, but not a boot encoded multiplier. Right? What you need to do is figure out what is the boot encoding, what does it actually implement, how do you write that out in a language like Verilog, how do you create modules for that, and how do you put the whole thing together as a complete module of its own. Okay, so that's what the assignment is going to be about. We'll discuss it a little bit more next year.